Welcome to this 12th podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. The series can be accessed via afmc.ca. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination related to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to quality improvement strategies and evaluation. We will talk about the differences between effectiveness, performance, and quality in addiction treatment, explain the difference between effective and quality care and identify a high-performance system, and look at the importance of creating a solid link between expectations and evaluation in order to produce practical outcomes for your program. To begin, effectiveness, performance, and quality in addiction treatment are not the same, but they are related elements of assessing the success or failure of a healthcare program. Effectiveness is a measure of patient outcomes following treatment. It is often assessed using patient follow-up at 6 and 12 months post-discharge. Popular measures of effectiveness include level of substance use, employment status, criminal activity, and overall health. Effectiveness yields definitive outcomes, but the process of data collection is slow and expensive, and the results are not always management relevant. Performance measures examine how the healthcare system functions during the course of treatment. Data are usually extracted from administrative records and operational practice databases, but several performance indicators are also direct patient measures of symptom severity and function. Performance measures are useful for monitoring short-term, that is weekly or monthly, changes in clinical activities, and thus represent interim results that can be used by management to make adjustments to operations. Quality is a combination of the two previous factors, as it reflects the convergence of effectiveness and performance. It's represented by a variety of measures, most often including agency licensing, program accreditation, staff credentials, client satisfaction, and use of evidence-based best practices. Quality is the true and comprehensive measure of a program's success or failure. So how do we apply the principles of effectiveness, performance, and quality in the healthcare setting? Remember that quality is the key measure of success or failure. Dr. Tom McClellan is the director of the Center on Substance Abuse Solutions at the University of Pennsylvania. Here he uses the three elements above to explain the difference between effective and quality care and to identify a high-performance system.
Effective care is that care, whatever you do, whether it's blowing in the patient's ear or high-level stuff, if it produces favorable outcomes, things that are valuable to society and valuable to the patient, you know, recovery, that's effective care. Now, quality care just is a summary. It's a sort of a higher concept, and it summarizes what we've just talked about. Quality care uses evidence-based methods and practices delivered by credentialed staff in licensed, accredited programs, and that care meets or exceeds what the patient and the payer expects. Oh, and high-performance systems do just that. They are able to identify the patients that need the care, initiate it for those who need it, and then engage and retain patients for the amount and duration of care that they need.
Evaluation is an extremely valuable tool for determining a program's success or failure, as it is a critical component of quality control and quality improvement efforts across every sector. Evaluation can be used to measure outcomes, processes, or the performance of systems and services in order to determine whether the intended result is being achieved and to guide decisions about implementation and management. However, it is imperative that you clearly define what you are evaluating. In order to determine the cost-benefit ratio of a program and guide decision-making going forward, for example, It's critical in the evaluation process to understand what you are measuring and how you are measuring it. Dr. McClellan explains the concept of measurement and how it is critical for addiction treatment programs.
You're first going to have to think about what it is you want and how you want to measure it. And this, by the way, in case you have lost all hope, this is where it gets interesting, okay? And here is where I think the kind of procedures that our field, and as a matter of fact, me, have been doing, have really shot our field in the foot. And it's given an unwarranted bad reputation to outcomes. That's interesting. Well, what do you mean, Tom? Well, it, first thing you got to think about is what you expect and when you expect it. Let's go to a brief review of the evidence. And it is a fact, but an embarrassing fact, that in terms of outcomes, outcomes now, recall, are what? That's when you measure drug use, employment, other things, 6 months, 12 months after treatment's over, right? If you measure outcomes and you do review the literature, you don't see much evidence that more thicker, intensive, expensive treatments are any better than brief, quick, skinny, cheap treatments. Ooh, boy, that's tough. 33 studies have been done comparing inpatient to outpatient treatment. Only one has shown a difference. That's my recent analysis. Conceptually different treatments. I'm going to show you an example of that. Don't give you different outcomes. What? How can that be? People who, the clinicians know this intuitively. You've got to match the kind of care to the kind of patient that's going to get that care. And that's a matched patient. And but somebody who doesn't get the care that's appropriate for them, that why they are mismatched. Yeah, well, the awkward thing is, 6 months or 12 months later, it don't make no difference. There's no difference in outcomes. We have cures in addiction. We must, because that's how you evaluate something if it's a cure. It's like a broken leg or an infection or something else. You give the treatment for the certain period of time. You stop the treatment. Then somebody like me comes along and evaluates whether or not the treatment has continued to work. That's called a cure. We ain't got no cures, okay? And so that you ought to be going, aha, right now. You ought to be saying, holy hell, maybe that's why this stuff is so true. Yeah, that's it. That's right. If you take a really brief treatment and a really intensive one, stop both of them. And they're both effective, let's say. You stop both of them. And you don't have a cure. And the symptoms come back for both of them. You're not going to see a difference 6 months or 12 months or 2 years later. If you take people who've been matched to receive just the right kind of care versus people who got mismatched, but you don't have a cure, and you stop both kinds of care, and you look at them 6 months or 12 months later, you're not going to see a difference.
Perhaps the most critical part of the evaluation process is to create a solid link between expectations and evaluation. In this sense, you can provide accurate, valid answers to the questions that patients, healthcare providers, and administrators are asking. In other words, good quality, pragmatic questions can be answered by evidence-based, good quality evaluation. High-quality addiction services are defined by the use of evidence-based clinical practices delivered by credentialed staff, working in licensed and accredited programs, applying evidence-based services, and which result in positive outcomes. In order to design and evaluate successful addiction programs, it's important to link and evaluate the entire continuum of care, from the patient and primary care physician right through to the specialist and outpatient treatment services. Dr. McClellan outlines how to evaluate the entire system of addiction treatment.
Everybody in the addiction field in the United States says, and if you ask all the purchasers of treatment, like the state directors, do you have a continuum of care in Kansas? Why, yes, we do. We have Shady Acres Treatment Program up here does our continuing care. It starts with our Lady of Perpetual Misery Hospital doing intensive outpatient program. And we have an outpatient program, and yes, we have Serenity Hills residential care as well. And we have it all. But that's very much like saying, I have a car. Why, the wheels I have up there in the bedroom, down there in the dining room beside the table, I have the transmission, and you know, the motor's over there by the kitchen. I got a car. That car don't go nowhere, okay? So one of the things we've been saying to states, and actually, Dave, you might want to do some of this stuff, is say, look, start buying what it is that is really going to be effective for the citizens of your state. If the continuum of care is what you really need, and learn from our mistakes in Delaware. One of the other things about the Delaware problem is that the detox was run by a company that had no affiliation whatsoever with a company that ran outpatient care or residential care. They were all different. They were all different entities. Start actually buying the continuum. Now, Florida is actually doing this. And they've said, I don't want to buy the pieces. If you guys, now you can all keep your independent status if you like, but for the purposes of the state contract, and oh, by the way, I buy 80% of all the care, I'm only going to buy when I am assured of seamless transitions between residential and intensive, outpatient to continuing. That's what I want. And oh, by the way, another thing I need is sober housing, because I can't keep the guys that have so many problems in care unless if they got no place sober to live. So if you can do that, I'm ready to purchase. I leave it to you to figure out the internal relationships that you want, or I'll build it myself. But if that's the point there is, use the power of the purchaser in a way that gets you what you really want. Don't just buy services, don't just buy procedures. Buy, wherever possible, results.
So here's a summary of the key points in this podcast. Quality is a combination of effectiveness and performance. Quality is the most comprehensive measure of a program's success or failure. While effective care produces favorable outcomes, quality care leads to high-performance systems through its use of evidence-based methods, accreditation, and licensing. It's critical to identify what elements of a program to measure and how to measure them in the evaluation process. Always create a solid link between expectations and evaluation in order to produce practical outcomes. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They are based on the CanMed's competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. How significant is this new knowledge in your understanding of quality improvement strategies and evaluation? 2. In your role as a medical student or practicing physician, have you seen an example of distinct addiction treatment services or care providers that are well connected and provide a continuum of care and can be evaluated as a cohesive program? 3. How does effective care become quality care in your program or practice? We hope that you've enjoyed this podcast on quality improvement strategies and evaluation. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this webpage, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with guidance from a project advisory committee and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. Narration was done by Hugh Kellum. This project was sponsored by the Norlin Foundation. The complete podcast series can be accessed via afmc.ca.